So drug court, like other diversion courts, are really about taking people who have committed a crime, but looking at that a little closer and with an eye of social justice, and recognizing that these crimes were not committed because these people are criminals. They were committed because these people have problems that aren't being dealt with. We try to look at this through compassion. Somebody who is doing residential burglary to get money for the drugs that they're using is somebody who needs help. They committed a crime, so yes, they end up in the system, but the thing with therapeutic courts and drug court is about saying, well, let's help this person, because we can go, okay, they're a criminal, throw them in prison, and then they get out and they go back to drugs and they do it again. If we don't really look at what the problem is, which is the addiction, we're just going to have repeat offenders. People are going to keep doing things over and over again because we're punishing the crime, but we're not treating the problem. And so drug court is about doing that. It's about saying, okay, let's not treat this person like a criminal. Let's give them an opportunity to turn their life around and not continue in this cycle of crime. What we do is we give them an opportunity. It is an optional program, so nobody is forced to do these programs. And in drug court, in particular, you're given an opportunity to start treatment, see what it's like. Is it something you want to do? And if they decide, yes, they're ready to change, I'm ready to put this behind me, then we opt them into the program. And they go through several phases. Each phase of advancement indicates success and progress in the program and treatment. And the great thing about the program when they're done is their felonies go away. They get erased from their record as though they never existed. And that's how we show, you know, we're going to treat this as an issue that needs to be treated instead of as a criminal that needs to be punished. And not having a felony on your record is a significant issue. Or it can be a significant thing for people. It can limit employment, housing, a number of public services that people might need, including voting rights and various things like that. So being able to live without that stigma is a big deal. The King County Drug Court Program is the 12th drug court program in the country. It was started in 1995. Now there are over 4,000 drug courts in the nation. So it is a model that the legal justice system is buying into, which is great because not everybody who ends up in the legal justice system is necessarily a criminal. When people first quit using drugs, that's the hardest part right there. Those first 3 to 6 months are critical. And because people oftentimes don't have or have forgotten their life skills and how to live life without them, they don't know what to do with themselves. And so we start them out with intensive services. So in a typical week, a newer drug court participant would probably be seen a minimum of 3 to 4 times a week. 3 of those would be a group therapy, and 1 of those would probably be an individual session. We will see them more if they need to be seen more. We really tailor our program to each individual. Some people find that stabilization very quickly, which is great. Some people struggle more than others. So it's hard to say, you know, oh, you're going to be stable in a month if you quit. Some people do stabilize that quickly, and other people, it takes 6 months. Sometimes they even need to go to inpatient, which we sometimes do. But what we evaluate is their stability in the community. How are they doing? How is their ability to follow through with responsibilities? And as that improves, drug court responsibilities begin to scale back, and we give them more time and see what they do with it. Now, oftentimes, they'll start going to school. Some people will get a job. Some people will go get their GED if they don't have that already. And we really see how they do as we scale back. Because as we scale back, if we see them kind of starting to falter, we just intensify again to kind of catch them as best we can before they fall back into old behaviors and using. So, you know, but the structure is there to provide support. And then as they stabilize and as they can create their own structure for themselves, we begin to scale back. And that's why we have a lot of contact, because we want them to be successful. We want them to be able to live life without us, because our goal is not to keep them in our program forever, despite what some people might think. But we don't actually want people to be here forever.